Okay. Yeah. Good afternoon, viewers both within Nigeria and outside the country. You are welcome to another edition of Daily Trust Television Program. Today, we shall be focusing on PDP on ending leadership tussle and implication on opposition politics and democracy. So we have in the house today a very key figure in journalism in Nigeria, who happens to be a former general manager of New Nigeria and a former editor of New Nigeria. The person in the house has also been a former managing editor of Daily Trust newspaper before he becomes the editor of Daily Trust. Today we have in the house the deputy editor-in-chief of Daily Trust newspaper in person of Malama Mahmud Jega. You are welcome to this edition of the program.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Just as I said, we are focusing on the PDP and on handling leadership also, implication on opposition politics and democracy. Maybe if I can start, what really is the meaning of the word opposition in any democracy?
In any democratic system, there will be a group, usually a political party that is involved. And then there will be a group that is hoping to one day replace them in power. Now, to be able to do that, they have to play a role at this time by keeping the rulers on their toes, pointing out their errors, pointing out problems with their programs and their implementation, and also offering different solutions. The hope is that their constant criticism will discredit the performance of the ruling party and also convince voters that they are a ready alternative, so that in the next election they could be elected to replace them in office. I think that is the summary of it.
So can we really say in Nigeria that is the way the opposition has been playing that role in this country?
The fact is that since we started this republic in 1999, we never had a very effective opposition party, except maybe between 2013 and 2015, when several opposition parties, together with a breakaway faction of the ruling party, coalesced together and formed the APC. That time we had a really vibrant opposition, which in fact succeeded for the first time in Nigeria's history in defeating the ruling party in a general election and taking power. But before that, and also since then, we really do not have very effective opposition parties. Since the PDP lost the general election and the presidential election in 2015, it almost immediately dissolved into chaos and factions. There is so much fighting, legal tussles, factions, everything. So honestly, it has been almost totally incapable of playing its role as an opposition party and keeping the ruling party, which is the APC, on its toes. And one of the effects of that is that the ruling party has also virtually gone to sleep because of the lack of a vibrant opposition. This is the first time that you have a ruling party that is hardly cohesive, it hardly holds meetings, it doesn't do anything. And that is really because there is no opposition, the way I see it.
Before we go, earlier on you said the opposition has not been really effective right from 1999 except up to 2013. Why was it impossible to have an effective opposition?
Sure. Honestly, it's a matter of conjuncture, because this country had a history of vibrant opposition parties. In the First Republic, for example, the contest between the ruling party and the opposition parties in the four regions that we had, as well as in the federal center, was very intense. In fact, so intense probably that it destroyed the republic. Now, in 1979 to 1983, when we first tried the presidential system of government, we also had five political parties. One was ruling at the center and in several states. The other four also were ruling in some states. And really, the contest between them that time was very, very intense, especially the Unity Party of Nigeria that time, which came second in the 79 election. It provided a very effective opposition to the ruling MPN, and it also got some of the other smaller parties, they banded together and were providing a very effective opposition. But after the 1999 election, which ushered in this republic, the parties that did not win really became disorganized and ineffective. And what we began to have was a mass migration into the parties that won. A lot of people were leaving the other parties and moving into the ruling party. So much so that it became so big, while the other smaller parties became weaker and weaker.
Why are they migrating to the other?
Oh, I don't know. It's a Nigerian condition, maybe, that created it. The power and the resources and the patronage in the federal government and also in the state governments is so intense that not many politicians wanted to remain in the opposition. That's one reason, but there was an even bigger one, which was the death of ideological politics. In the First Republic and in the Second Republic, we had political parties that were built on some ideological foundations. And it was not easy for people to abandon one and cross to the other. But in this republic, we ended up with political parties that were totally indistinguishable ideologically. So it was completely easy for you to wake up in the morning and walk from one political party into another. That's the summary of it.
Yeah, you say in the First Republic and the Second Republic,
yeah,
the political party then they can be distinguished ideologically.
Yeah.
So what are those key issues that made some of those parties there distinguished?
Well, ideologically, you see, there were left-wing parties and there were right-wing parties. Some parties were conservative, that means they were inclined towards free market capitalism, whereas other parties were socialist inclined, or welfareist inclined, and were left-wing and radical, they had a radical agenda and all that. Although even in the First Republic and also in the Second Republic, there was a mixture of some of that with the contest between different regions of the country. So to that extent, some politicians defined themselves up to the Second Republic as progressive politicians, and those were the ones campaigning for free education, free healthcare, some kind of redistribution of wealth and this and that. Whereas there were the ones who described themselves as conservative politicians. They want to maintain traditional institutions, they want to maintain the capitalist system, they want free market economics, they want to privatize state-owned farms and economic sectors and things like that. And to some extent, even in the Third Republic, which was essentially created by the military, when the Babangida administration created two political parties in 1990, the NRC and the SDP, it said that, one, the NRC should be a little to the right, and that the SDP should be a little to the left. And the politicians distributed themselves along those lines. Those who felt that they were left inclined, they went to SDP. Those that felt they were inclined to the right, they went to NRC. But in this republic, we have absolutely nothing of the sort. There is no ideological distinction between PDP and APC or AMPP that we had before or any of the other parties.
So what could be responsible for that?
Well, partly because maybe of the collapse of the communist system worldwide, the fall of the Soviet Union, and the collapse of the East Bloc made left-wing politics throughout the world to be on the retreat. I think that was the main factor which affected individual countries like us.
Nigeria, we practice presidential system of government, unlike the parliamentary system of government in the UK, where we have a shadow, they can form shadow ministers and the like. So what do you think, can Nigeria really borrow anything from the parliamentary system of government in terms of the
population? Well, as you know, in the First Republic, we had a parliamentary system of government. It collapsed in 1966 when it was overthrown by the military. In 1975, when the Murtala Obasanjo administration began the transition to civil rule, General Murtala Mohammed appointed a committee to draft a new constitution that would usher in the Second Republic. And when he was inaugurating the panel, headed that time by Chief Rotimi Williams, he said that the parliamentary system had been tried in Nigeria and it failed, that many people think the acrimony that we had in the First Republic was because of the parliamentary system. So maybe it is better to try the presidential system of government. And he gave his reasons, because you see, in the parliamentary system, the prime minister is elected from just one small constituency to the parliament. Then as the leader of the ruling party, he becomes the prime minister. But the president, like we have now, is elected in a nationwide election. So voters all over the country must vote for him, and he must win not only the highest number of votes, but he must also get at least a quarter of the votes in two-thirds of the seat. So that made him some kind of national figure. Now, that arrangement was adopted because we thought the biggest problem we had in the First Republic was regionalism, a leader who is inclined to one zone or another. But then if you elect a president with this nationwide mandate, then it will solve that problem. Well, maybe it solved one problem and created the other ones as we are experiencing now.
Yeah, in Nigeria we have quite a number of opposition parties. Mm. But the major one is the People's Democratic Party, which lost its power in 2015.
Yes.
Now we have ceaseless crisis in the former party, which claimed to rule Nigeria for several years. So what are the implications of this crisis in the major opposition party to Nigeria's democracy?
Well, honestly, it is very harmful. Although you see, many Nigerians don't seem to understand it that way. Many of the millions of Nigerians who got together to vote out PDP in 2015 because of its very poor governance record between 1999 and 2015 feel that we don't need that party, it is evil, it is even good if it scatters and dissolves. That seems to be the feeling of many Nigerians. But personally, I don't feel that way. The fact is, whoever you elect into office, however good their promises or however good or saintly you think the new rulers are, honestly, they need an opposition group to keep them on their toes. As we can see, you see, some of the policy options that the APC has adopted since 2015. Of course, APC leaders say they didn't create all these problems, it was PDP that created them. Fine, but you are responsible for the solution. And you are responsible for the options that you choose in the search for the solution. And that is where the role of the opposition is very important, because they should constantly critique the options that you choose. That, okay, you didn't create the economic crisis, but this method that you are following to try to bring it to an end will not bring it to an end, or it will not bring it to an end early enough, or it might compound the problem. See, this is part of the role of the opposition. Or it might criticize the ruling government based on the pace. It might be you are doing the right thing, but you are doing it too slowly. See, all kinds of things. So we do need a vibrant and dynamic opposition. And if at some point, after 4 years or 8 years or so, the APC falters,
it is very important to have a ready alternative. Because if we don't have an alternative, then virtually that is the end of the democratic order. Because the only thing that will keep people on their elected people on their toes is to know that if voters at any stage become dissatisfied with them, they will shift to an alternative. Now, what happens if there is no alternative? Then that is not healthy. That cannot be healthy at all for the democratic order.
So, do you think the PDP can play this role?
Right now, it cannot play that role. The crisis in the PDP is multifarious, although, if you ask me, it is one person, Alimadu Sharif. Maybe he is right and aggrieved at the way the PDP governors invited him to come and lead the party. Then they suddenly tried to ditch him, and they didn't do it honorably or properly or anything, although they also have their own reason. According to what you read in the various papers, they said after becoming chairman, he wanted to become presidential candidate, and he was playing the governors against one another. Those are some of the allegations. It's not possible sometimes in a conflict between politicians to tell who is telling the truth, because it's not about truth, it's about everybody pursuing his interests. But otherwise, what you can observe is that maybe 90% or more of the members of the PDP are with the Makarifi faction. Certainly all the governors and the members of the national assemblies and state assemblies are with the Makarifi faction. But for now, the Alimadu Sharif faction has got a legal advantage because of the victory that he won at the Port Harcourt division of the Court of Appeal. So I think that maybe it is time for the majority in the PDP to examine their options, including abandoning the PDP and forming another party or taking over another small party. Since they are quite many, they have many governors, they have many legislators, they have resources, they have members all over the country, they can still form another dynamic opposition party and prepare themselves as an alternative in case APC falters in the future.
Yeah, let's take some of the questions from our viewers who are watching us live. Habib Sadiq is asking the question, how can the crisis in the PDP be resolved when 45% of Makarifi faction are allegedly supporting Sharif secretly?
Well, I have no way of knowing whether 45 or any percentage are supporting Alimadu Sharif secretly. But what we can see from outside is that all the PDP governors are behind the Makarifi faction, including almost all the members of the National Assembly and also most members of the state assemblies controlled by PDP, as well as most of the prominent members across the country. Now, if that is the case, I think they can get together and examine their options and move en bloc into another group. There are so many other political parties, I think about 25 or so registered. They can take over one. They can take over one small one. In fact, probably that is better for them, because for now, I think in Nigerian politics, the name PDP is even a liability. Although it has its advantage, maybe because everybody knows it. But even if everybody knows it, but knows it for the wrong reason, it is good probably to even abandon that name and go and form another party, take over one small party, and make it a vibrant opposition. That is one option, because otherwise, I don't see this thing happening, except if maybe the Makarifi faction wins at the Supreme Court. But that will also rob them of some time, because if you appeal now to Supreme Court, I don't know how long it will take. It may take another 1 year. And by now, they should probably start getting their act together and preparing for 2019. I'm not their strategic advisor, but that's what I see from outside.
Yeah, Isiaku Mohammed is asking, what would be the implication of opening the PDP headquarters for Madu Sharif has been reported?
Well, I really don't know, because although he won the ruling at the Court of Appeal, but the Makarifi faction said they are appealing to the Supreme Court. So it is possible for them to ask for a stay. They should not be allowed to take over the headquarters until the matter is finally decided at the Supreme Court. But even if he is allowed to take it over now, well, it's a symbolic victory. I don't think it is much of a victory, because I have seen a statement somewhere of the workers in the PDP secretariat saying they are loyal to the Makarifi faction. Therefore, even if Ali Madu Sharif opens the Wadata Plaza, they will not report there. I saw a report like that.
Yeah, Ismail Musa Alaji is asking, what do you think is the, are the chances of the PDP going to the 2019 election with this crisis?
Well, we'll go to the election. However disorganized, I don't know. Certainly, they have to resolve this problem one way or another well before the 2019 election. And as I said, since most of them are in one faction, that is the Makarifi faction, that is the faction that has to decide essentially what it should do before 2019, either to abandon the PDP name and paraphernalia to the Sharif faction and move en masse, because they are strong enough, I mean, to go and take over somewhere and make it vibrant.
So if you they can follow that, this kind of advice, what would be the, because the party, the PDP, is an household name in the country, and we shouldn't forget that they also have a secretariat, multi-billion naira secretariat. So what will happen to that kind of asset?
I don't even think that building belongs to PDP. I read a report some years ago that they are also renting it. Maybe it's owned by one of the members, but I don't think, you know, they were doing some fundraising during the Jonathan administration, according to them, to build a secretariat, which suggests it's a temporary secretariat. It's probably not even owned by them. In any case, what is secretariat? And what is also even name? You can open another secretariat, and within a few years it can become as popular as this one, or even name. Quite all right, the name PDP is well known all over Nigeria for 17, 18 years now. But as I said, sometimes you can be known for the wrong reason. And the name PDP now is a liability. Many parts of the country now, if you say PDP, people equate it with squander and misrule and everything. So actually, strategically, it may actually be better to start on a clean slate.
Yeah, I think this is where we shall be drawing the curtains on today's edition of our interview. But before we call it a day, let me say a very thank you to our guest for today, Malam Mahmud Jega. We hope that when next we knock on your door, you feel willingly and cheerfully heed to our request for any of this kind of interaction. So we thank you. We also appreciate the crew who have made to this program a success. I will say thank you to the person who has been recording, in person of Mr. Kamaluddin Ismail, who is the cameraman. We also appreciate the effort of the online editor, Mr. Abiodun, and we also appreciate the effort of the IT department, the creative department. So I am Muhyiddin Olaniyi. So see you.